From the Reynolds Journalism Institute at the University of Missouri, welcome to Global Journalist. I'm Jason McClure. For much of its population, Somalia is a difficult and dangerous place to live. That's particularly true for reporters. Practicing journalism in a failed state means facing threats from any number of militia groups. That includes Islamist radicals from al-Shabaab, as well as from armed groups loyal to Somalia's internationally backed government in Mogadishu. At least 59 Somali journalists have been killed since the start of 1992, the year after the fall of dictator Siad Barre threw the country into chaos. But in spite of the extreme dangers and the absence of rule of law, Somalia has dozens of private radio stations, as well as its own TV stations, and hundreds of print and online media outlets. On this edition of Global Journalist, we're going to take a look at the state of journalism in Somalia. We've got a couple great guests coming on the show right now, the first of which, Omar Farouk Osman. He's president of the National Union of Somali Journalists, a group that is actually split into a couple different factions. We're also joined by Adil Abdi Osman. She's a lecturer at the University of Leicester in England. Previously, she's been a reporter for Voice of America, the BBC, and other outlets covering Somalia. Adil Abdi Osman, welcome to you. Tell us just a little bit about how Somali journalists go about practicing journalism in Mogadishu and in southern Somalia, given sort of what a dangerous and chaotic place it is. What does your daily life look like there?
Well, I haven't been practicing journalism in Somalia for a couple of years now, but I assume what the day-to-day practicalities of a journalist in Somalia today would be very much the same in many regards as journalists anywhere else in the world. They have to collect the stories, they have to look for what the daily news is, speak to different potential interviewers and so on. But what they have to bear in mind is protecting their own safety, and that means checking the places that they can go to, where they cannot go to, people that they can speak to, people that they can't speak to. So in many ways they have barriers and complicated situations that they have to maneuver around in order for them to do their job.
Omar Farouk Osman, you're the president of the National Union of Somali Journalists. You're in Mogadishu. I understand there was recently an attempt on your life. Can you give us just a picture of what protecting your own security in Mogadishu means as a journalist?
Well, Mogadishu, you know, as people, you know, see from the news, it's a place where, you know, civilians suffer, you know, attacks. It's a suicide attack, it's, organized crimes, you know, assassinations of politicians and journalists and civil society and human rights activists. But the attack that happened to me during the Christmas period, 29 December, it was basically about, all these crimes that are happening, because we have been, campaigning against those who are killing journalists. And it's taking from, persecution with impunity, because journalists are being killed and targeted for the sake of, what they write, what they say, what they publish. A very uncomfortable truth that politicians or business people or other people do not want it. The day before my attack, a media law was passed in the federal parliament, and we have had a very strong views on that. Specifically, the issue here is it's required journalists to be having a university degree in journalism, which is making journalism not an open profession, but a closed profession. And we all know that journalists in Somalia, or those who wanted to be journalists, do not have university degree in journalism, let alone a university degree. We were also protesting about these findings, because journalists be punished by $500 to $3,000, and you could see that a poor journalist who is paying $20, $30, $50 a month as a salary, when that journalist is fired, we say between $500 to $3,000.
Well, let me just stop you there, Omar Farouk Osman, because I do want to turn that point that you just made back to Adil Abdi Osman, and Omar was talking about sort of the low pay and difficult working conditions that Somali journalists face in Mogadishu. Can you give us just a picture as to what some of the challenges are in terms of professionalism? I saw that there was a recent report from the Committee to Protect Journalists that called some media houses in Somalia slander machines, in essence, that they were sort of like these playthings of tycoons or big men who use them to sort of damage the reputation of their rivals.
Well, I mean, on one hand, it is a very difficult situation to work in when you don't have the pay that you would normally get on a monthly basis. A lot of the times the journalists in Somalia tend to work for free, or they get very meager wages. So they have to find other means to make a living, and that often means that they find themselves in uncomfortable situations that could end up harming their lives or the lives of their loved ones. On the other hand, when, like Umar Farooq said, when you've got a situation where there's complete state collapse, there aren't any institutions that are providing education and training for these journalists to actually be able to do their work in a professional manner, that creates a situation where most of these reporters are actually just amateur citizen journalists, and they're operating in a mainstream media expected environment. So that's where I think the perplexity or the complexity comes from when they have to do their job, but it creates all these difficult issues that then tend to harm their lives, but also make the situation a lot more unbearable, I think.
And Adil, if you could tell us, how do you know that you are being threatened in Somalia? Do you receive telephone calls as a journalist? Is it always clear where the threats are coming from?
If it's coming from ideological groups such as al-Shabaab, that's often the message, you know, the form of communication they use. They'll either send you a text message or they'll call you. They'll warn you, they'll give you warnings beforehand before they actually carry out specific threats. Sometimes they might threaten you outright. But then, you know, there's so many different groups. You know, al-Shabaab is probably the most pronounced one, but there are many other factions that are of opposing interests. And these are the fighting elements that are causing the chaos in Somalia, within which the reporters have to operate.
And so when you receive a threat, then do you typically know, like, well, I did this story and therefore the Islamist al-Shabaab is angry at me, so I'm in trouble with them? Or is it sometimes not clear whether the government is after you or a militia or al-Shabaab?
Well, if it's al-Shabaab, they'll tell you exactly the problem that they have with you. If it's a particular article or an interview that you've given, they'll either speak to you about it or they'll send you a message explicitly stating what the issue is that they have with you. With other groups, it's not so clear cut. You know, sometimes they might send people to you that will give you some kind of hint or, you know, like a mixed message for you to see as a signal or as a warning. So it's a different methods of communication. Sometimes it's straightforward, sometimes it's a bit more complicated.
There is a reporter who is in exile in Kenya named Abdali Ahmed Mumin. I understand that he was exiled after he wrote a news story for the Wall Street Journal, Adil, in which he reported on the death of al-Shabaab's leader in 2014. He was killed in a drone strike by the U.S. And just reporting the fact that the Shabaab leader was killed was enough for him to be threatened. Is that normal for there to be sort of red lines so tightly around journalists?
Jason, it's a very difficult situation. I mean, you're operating in an environment where the rule of law is not really upheld. And when you've got groups that don't recognize other groups as a legitimate force, then they will operate as the de facto authority within that environment. And that's how al-Shabaab is operating at the moment. So I don't know the specific issue regarding Mr. Mu'min, but in general terms, if you have committed an act that al-Shabaab considers to be against what they stand for, they will threaten you. That's something that has happened over and over again.
Talk to us just a little bit about how foreign journalists operate in Somalia. I recall reading a piece in the New York Times by their correspondent Jeffrey Gettleman in East Africa. He spoke about traveling to Somalia basically with his own private army. How do foreign journalists, are they able to get news from Somalia effectively?
If you're traveling with an army of your own, I wouldn't say you're able to get it effectively, because that effect, you know, by default stops you from accessing a lot of areas and mingling with the local people. I think for foreign journalists, it's it's kind of an expected shield to protect themselves when they go to a place like Mogadishu. They surround themselves with their own personal security guards. On one hand, I think that gives them the reassurance that they need in order to operate there safely. On the other hand, I personally think that, you know, the less statement that you make with your appearance, the more likely you are to blend in and for people to accept you as someone who's not a threat, because people tend to have these, you know, cautious kind of thinking of, well, why does this person feel the need to protect himself so much?
But of course, there have been a number of foreign journalists who have been kidnapped in Somalia.
And that's what happens in conflict zones. It's the risk that you're willing to take.
Well, let me turn this now to back to you, Omar Farouk Osman. Could you tell us just a little bit about restrictions from the Somali government on journalists? We did hear a bit about some of the difficulties that journalists face from al-Shabaab. I understand that the Somali government has passed a new media law. You referenced earlier in the program that it requires that journalists have a degree from an accredited university, except that as of now, there is no school in Somalia that offers journalism degrees. Tell us just a little bit about this law.
The law was first passed by the bill, let me say that, was passed in September 2015. And, I mean, there was huge protest from the media because it was a very, very draconian media bill. And, you know, because there were a lot of issues there, you know, a media regulatory body, which is like a media council, which is not independent and completely dominated by the government establishment. And also, fines, and also, the bill was foreseeing criminal offenses for journalists that have to be prosecuted by the attorney general. And that was very serious for us. So there's a huge protest, and it took some time. Finally, the parliament has passed it in December 28th, 2015, when, it was passed, it was signed into law by the presidency. This law has a lot of, articles or provisions which are very restrictive. Yes, I mentioned the issue of university degree in journalism, but it's really, really a very serious issue because according to this law, 99.9% currently working journalists will not be recognized by as journalists by this law because they don't have a university degree in journalism. That's the first thing. The second thing here is the issue of the National Media Commission, or Somali Media Commission. It's supposed to be an independent regulatory body for the media, but yet it's not an independent regulatory body because, the private media is very underrepresented, and those who are not from the media and those who are coming from the state media, because we do not have public service media now, we have state media, are dominating. And that, creates the problem for us. And then the other issue is setting the code of ethics of journalism. And according to this law, it says that the Ministry of Information, in consultation with the media, will develop, the code of ethics. And for us, we see it like the government wanting to please the media and by setting the rules to follow. And we strongly believe as a union that for ethics of journalism and code of conduct, it is up to the journalists, and it should be left exclusively for journalists to decide without the involvement and the interference of the government.
So Omar Farouk, if I could just stop you there then to sum up your points then, it sounds like you have particular objections about the formation of this media commission and who's going to be on it, on how this code of ethics that the Somali government is putting into place is being developed, and the fact that 99.9% of working journalists will effectively be declared illegal for not having a journalism degree under this new law then. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, exactly, because that's why we have challenged this law, and we said, look, yes, we need a media law that regulates the media, that, you know, because the journalists have now been arrested, they are being punished under the Ben Al Code, which is, very old, and, you know, USSR, you know, Soviet Union style, the Ben Al Code is being used, under, the vertex of false news or defamation or, sedition, charges. And all this, we expected this media law to be the space for the media, and so that we can protect the rights.
Well, let me just stop you there, because we do have to take a brief break here to remind our listeners that this is Global Journalist. I'm Jason McClure. This week, a look at the challenges of being a reporter in the failed state of Somalia. Joining us now from the University of Leicester is Edil Abdi Osman. She's a lecturer at the University of Leicester. She spent years as a BBC VOA reporter covering Somalia. Joining us also from Mogadishu, Somalia, Omar Farouk Osman of the National Union of Somali Journalists. Edil Abdi Osman, I was hoping that you could tell us just a little bit about how Somali journalists are perceived in Somali society, because I understand that they have a relatively high status. I was actually traveling in East Africa a number of years ago with a reporter for the BBC named Abdulrahim Karanto, and I remember going through a Somali area of a city with him, and he was literally mobbed by people. He was like this incredibly popular figure. It was almost like traveling with Brad Pitt in a way. Can you tell us just a little bit about that phenomenon?
Well, yes, I mean, the Somali journalists are really the celebrity of society, so to speak. It's a profession that's very much honored. It's considered to be a privilege to be a journalist. And this is often associated with Somalis being, considered the nation of poets. And they value oral communication and presentation and anything within the communicative means in very high regard. So when someone is a journalist, they're almost the pillars of society, or they represent the pillars of society. And this has become even more pronounced now that Somalis are so dispersed across the globe. So you've got a large concentration of Somalis within Somalia and the Horn in general, but then you have a very large diaspora community. And the one thing that keeps them all connected and well-informed about Somalia and each other is the Somali media.
Just a quick reminder that if you're interested in more Global Journalist content, visit us online at globaljournalist.org. There you can read our ongoing series of interviews with journalists in exile around the world and coverage of foreign affairs and press freedom issues. We're also on social media. You can like us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at @GlobalJourn. Omar Farouk Osman of the National Union of Somali Journalists. There is one aspect of Somali media that I thought was particularly interesting, and that is that it sounds like it's rather commonplace for reporters to take bribes, to take payments from people in return for covering particular stories. Is that really the case?
Well, yes. There is that this kind of, that killed the quality of journalism. And we call it brown envelope, we call it sharur, we call it, all sorts of names, okay? Which is really a very serious issue. It kills quality of journalism. And part of it is contributed by the poor working conditions, because when journalists are poorly employed, when they are poorly paid, when they are working in poor working conditions, then they are forced to do all sorts of things because that is exactly what is happening now, especially the situation as it is now. The journalists are poorly paid. They don't have good pay, and politicians or newsmakers try to manipulate them by giving them money.
Well, let me just ask you about the reporters themselves as well. I understand that a number of the reporters for some of the biggest radio stations and media outlets in Somalia are actually teenagers, and that some radio stations, such as Shabelle Radio, they actually hire individuals as young as 15 years old, 16 years old. Is that really the case?
No, that's not the case. Well, look, most of the journalists are youngsters. That one is true. But, it's not only Shabelle who employ young journalists, but they're not teenagers, and according to the Somalia context, they're not teenagers. And in real terms, it's not particular to one media house. It's most of the media houses who abuse that. And the fact that they use some of the media owners is that because for young journalists' salary or payment can only be taken by one, you know, old veteran journalist. So instead of employing a veteran journalist, then that is what they do, you know. And for us, that is the most important thing for people to address is these youngsters, unskilled, they need to be trained. They need to have the they need to know basics of journalism. They need to know what is happening, you know, in their profession before they go to the job, before they go to assignments. And some of them, they are doing a very dangerous assignment is where, you know, it's like you know, people are fighting or, you know, there are bombardment, or there's a suicide bombing. So it's a very dangerous place that they go, which is really making some serious, you know, question of what to do and how to do their work.
Now, it was reported last year that Somalia's government tried to ban media outlets from using the name al-Shabaab in reference to the militant group. They wanted you to use, if I understand correctly, the word Ugus, which is sort of an acronym for the group that massacres people. Is that still the case? Are these sorts of dictates normal?
Well, yes. The government said that, you know, you should call al-Shabaab Ugus. But to be honest with you, al-Shabaab is infamous for its name al-Shabaab. So people use it, you know, normally, you know, even the media, al-Shabaab, you know, you hear it, you know, sometimes from the state media calling al-Shabaab Ugus. But to be honest with you, you know, ordinary people, local journalists, most of them, they use the word al-Shabaab and they call them because no matter how we consider their views and their actions and what we regard them and what we see them, al-Shabaab is a newsmaker in Somalia at the moment, and people have to call it is the name it calls itself so that people can identify them. Even if they are doing terrorist acts, if they are doing criminal acts, that people would not, you know, support at all.
I wanted to ask you as well about the issue of corruption in Somalia. I understand that 2 or 3 years ago, there were a number of journalists who were covering this story about the port in Mogadishu, which is one of the main revenue sources for the current government in Somalia. And there had been some reports that as much as 75% of the fees from the port that were supposed to go to the Somali government were in fact disappearing and being stolen in effect. Now, two of the journalists that had been covering this story turned up dead sort of shortly after they began covering it. Can you tell us a little bit about the issue of corruption?
Yeah, the two journalists were killed from Radio Shabelle, and they were covering basically about what was happening at the port. That's what I said earlier, that, you know, journalists die in two ways. One is someone caught in a bomb blast or a suicide bomb, and that the person dies in such situation. And then the other is a targeted killing. And the targeted killing is like part of this, you know, telling truth, you know, revealing it, you know, exposing it. It is a very serious issue, and it's a very dangerous issue. Once you start telling the truth or, you know, unearthing something which is, you know, uncomfortable truth by someone, then you are risking your life. And that is what, you know, Ado Anshur and Hassan Fantastic, both of them, you know, they were killed. And there is a suspect that they were killed on this basis.
And this actually brings us to another point, which we touched on just a bit earlier in the show, but that is the question of impunity. In that Somalia has had something like 59 journalists killed over the past 12 years. How many of those who have killed journalists have been prosecuted for doing that?
Like the National Union of Somali Journalists said, you know, so far we have, you know, 4 cases of journalist killers caught by the National Intelligence and Security since 2006, since the killings of 2006. So these killings of journalists and the impunity is a very serious issue, because that clearly states what it is, and that the targeted attacks of journalists is a very serious issue, because it just shows the way it is, the journalists are killing this have become normal, and impunity is part of it, because those who kill journalists, they know that nobody is going to hold them accountable, no one is going to investigate them, and those who killed journalists that were caught by the intelligence are al-Shabaab. But not all of the killings of journalists were behind al-Shabaab, because the killings were organized by other forces who killed journalists. And that is a very, very serious matter that people have to know that how to tackle impunity. And we always say that there is a lack of a political interest with regard to impunity and how it is tackled on that issue.
Let me just ask you about this question of political interest in justice and fighting impunity, because as many of our listeners know, of course, the Somali government controls some towns and cities in southern Somalia with the help of African Union peacekeepers. And of course, there's al-Shabaab and other factions that control other areas of the country. What is the relationship between the media and these international peacekeepers who are there to, in effect, rebuild Somalia and try to restore the rule of law?
Well, there is no particular protection that the African Union provides to the media except what they do for the general public. The African Union forces, they never arrested, they never prosecuted.
Oh, I'm sorry, we've got some interference on your line, Omar Farouk. We do have time. We have just about 30 seconds left. If I could ask you, what is your view of sort of what's going to happen in the future? You were talking about the role of the African Union there. What is it going to look like for Somali journalists 2 years from now, 3 years from now?
Well, we hope that there will be stability. We hope that the law enforcement will work. We hope that judiciary will work, and those who are targeting journalists will be taken to the justice, and they will be persecuted. That is really a very important issue for us. Yes, it is an issue that needs to be addressed, and impunity is the problem, which is flourishing in instability and lack of peace in our country now.
That'll do it for this edition of Global Journalist, a production of the Reynolds Journalism Institute and the Missouri School of Journalism. Many thanks to Omar Farouk Osman and Dr. Adil Osman for joining us today. For all of us here at Global Journalist, thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week.